Let us pray. Guide us, O God, by your word and Holy Spirit, that in your light we may see light, in your truth find freedom, and in your will discover peace, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Hear this reading today from the book of Amos, chapter 5, verses 21 through 24. I reject your festivals. I don't enjoy your joyous assemblies. If you bring me your entirely burned offerings and gifts of food, I won't be pleased. I won't even look at your offerings of well-fed animals. Take away the noise of your songs. I won't listen to the melody of your harps. But let the justice roll down like waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. And this reading comes from the book of John, chapter 7, verses 37 and 38. On the last and most important day of the festival, Jesus stood up and shouted, "All who are thirsty should come to me. All who believe in me should drink. As the scriptures said concerning me, rivers of living water will flow out from within him." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Well, today is Halloween, and it is one of my favorite days of all time. I love the carved jack-o'-lanterns. I love the spooky decorations, the candy, and I especially love the costumes. I enjoyed hearing the children share about what they are going to be this evening. Just on Friday at Covenant, where I serve in Roanoke, we had the preschool trunk or treat. And all the kids came dressed up, and I just got so much joy out of seeing, we had Elsa, we had Ariel, we also had Spider-Man and Swamp Thing and cowboys and cowgirls, and as well as, I'm trying to think, there was just so many, but my favorite was Mary Poppins, and she had put her costume together all by herself, and it was just so much fun. And costumes, I think, even for us adults, they give us this short little spurt of time to disguise who we really are, a license to pretend and imagine being something that we're not, someone we're not, or someone we want to be, but we're not there yet, or someone we would never be in any other case. But our scripture reading today puts us into a scene of worship. And it seems that the people there have been pretending to be people of God, but in reality, their lives aren't reflecting it. They're gathered together in their house of worship, probably near the city of Bethel, which the word itself means house of God. And these people have been faithful in their worship. They have been assembling together in a very solemn way. They've been worshiping with feasts. They've worshiped with offerings of many kinds, burnt offerings, grain offerings, peace offerings. And their worship took a beautiful form with songs of praise, even with instruments like the harp. And these people from the northern kingdom, basically, they were doing worship right, just the way God had instructed them to do. But in the middle of this scene, Amos, a prophet who started out his life as a fig farmer and a goat herder, he's from the southern kingdom, the southern region of Judah. And in those days and times, the prophets, like Amos, worked to remind the leaders and God's people of when they had gotten off course. The prophets were known to do crazy things to get people's attention, and they were fairly bold. They had bold messages. They did all this to get the people's attention so that they would listen. And prophets pointed out the good, the bad, the ugly to keep everyone in tune with God's plan. So here they are in this context of worship, and in walks Amos. And Amos faces the worshipers and he shares this message from God. He says, "You think you're so solemn gathered here today? Well, God knows it's all a disguise. It's a show for everyone watching, and God knows it." And then Amos gestures to the offering, maybe the offering plates, and he shouts, "And your offerings, their grain, the grain offerings, the burnt offerings, the peace offerings, God knows that's a farce too. It looks like you're giving, but in reality, God knows you're not." And then Amos approaches the musicians, and he proclaims, "This music that you sing, it may sound beautiful, but it's nothing but noise to God." Can you imagine sitting there? About right now, probably everyone in that congregation, probably their dander was up. They might have been thinking, "Who is this guy? And who does he think he is? Clearly, he isn't from around here." But perhaps some of their consciences have been plucked a little bit too. Amos had touched upon just about everything that they were doing faithfully in worship, and all the outside, outward things that had made it seem as if they were godly people were being challenged. And in fairness, I suspect this congregation may have been a bit confused, because their feasts, their offerings, the worship music, these were all things that God had told them to do, and they were doing them obediently. But the next verse from our scripture shed some light on the issue that was really at play under the surface here. "But let justice roll down like waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream." You see, back during Amos's day, the worship was becoming kind of routine. Yes, they were honoring God's instructions about how to engage in worship, but worship had become kind of mundane. Yes, they were obedient, but the reality was they were kind of just going through the motions. And probably we've all been there at some time or another. And in the midst of these peaceful and prosperous times, they had forgotten to live out their faith in their daily lives outside of the worship space. Outside of this worship space, Many of the followers of God were taking advantage of the poor. Small farmers were being charged with high rent prices in their day. Landlords who gathered for worship were taking large shares of the crops from the poor people. And on top of that, the justice system had become corrupt. Judges, many of whom were part of the worship congregation, accepted bribes. And so their verdicts often favored the wealthy, and the poor couldn't afford proper representation. There had become a gap between the haves and the have-nots in their society. And the very people who engaged in proper worship walked right out of the temple and took advantage of the poor in the courts, in the businesses, and wherever they could get a little more from those who needed it most. No one was addressing the reasons between those gaps, between the haves and the have-nots. In other words, there was no true justice in their society. And this broke God's heart. So Amos's startling message to the people was God's way of telling them that they had forgotten something. They had forgotten that they were once slaves. They were once powerless. And they were once needy of all things. God had delivered them from all of this. And they had forgotten. They had forgotten God's commands to help those who needed it most. And God was telling them that when the poor and the helpless in society are not being tended to, worship itself has no value. True worship spills out and overflows into our lives. Worship that overflows loves. Worship that overflows acts in kindness, does justice and righteousness in every aspect of life outside of the temple walls. And so the prophetic voice in scripture here never ceases to give us eyes to see in new ways. And while we in today's world have to keep the context of this scripture in check, it does make me wonder, what could our churches, meaning Big C Church, learn from this scenario? What can we churches in today's world learn from God's message delivered via Amos? Like the people in our scripture passage, we too live in a fairly peaceful and prosperous time, considering. Yet, injustices continue to radiate among us. Racism is still alive and well in our midst. I know personally some beloved members of my extended family have three precious adopted children. The oldest is a child of color, and his brother and sister, also adopted, are very white and blonde and look like they could be my children. Last year, they were at a fall festival, getting candy and treats at this time of the year. At one particular booth, I'll call him Andy, the oldest, approached and asked politely if he could have some candy. The person, in a very harsh voice to a child, said, "You can only take one piece and one piece only." He did. Later on, his two siblings come behind him. They asked for candy and were told to get as much as they wanted. This happens to them every single week in some way, shape, or form. On a different end, food deserts exist in our midst. There are sections of our regions where for miles and miles and miles, food with nutrition is nowhere to be found. The only options are fast food and convenience store commodities for many, which are pricey. Spend some time in our local community outreach centers, and you will see how our system often fails people. In the waiting room at one such place, I met a woman who works two jobs, rides the bus to work, and she told me that she gets robbed on her way home almost every single day. I have met people who, after they pay rent, care for their children's school needs, address their utilities, they have nothing left to feed their families. And one day, a man walked into such a place and said that he wanted to know, he heard that it was a place where he could get food. And he looked at me and he said, "For the first time in my life, I'm hungry." He went on to share that his father had passed away and he had used all the money he had to give his father a proper burial. I met another man who said he was homeless. And then he went on to share with me how good God had been to him. As a society, I think we've almost created boundaries in our neighborhood lines that divide us to the point that we don't even have to see the poverty that's around us, much less attend to it if we don't drive out of our own spaces. So Amos's words give us eyes to start to look for where these gaps may exist. Now, sometimes people get a little sensitive and they think, "Oh, this don't go talking politics in the pulpit." I'm not talking politically, this is biblical. So no matter where anyone falls on any political spectrum, Amos invites us as a family of faith to look around and to examine the injustices that are all around us. Around our nation, we have families who struggle due to a lack of a living wage. We have shootings that still take place. We have healthcare issues. We have teachers and students who are struggling in the midst of this pandemic. We have families separated at our borders, and we have drug issues that still pervade. Some teachers are on food stamps. But back to Amos. Polluted as the waters of justice were during his day, the Lord is offering the people in this context an alternative view, a view that should be and could be, to illustrate the point, God gives them a visual, something they could all relate to in a very real way, the visual of water. Let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. In the land of Israel, most streams and water sources were seasonal. During the rainy season, the land was full of life, but during the summers of the hot, dry season, the land was dry and barren. The Hebrew translation of ever-flowing stream refers to a torrent of water, water that gushes and floods. Water so powerful that it can change anything's course. Ever-flowing streams flow so freely and so fully and so continuously that life thrives. And this is the Lord's picture of justice. Justice shouldn't be something that happens in spurts in a seasonal kind of way. Justice is not something we do for one day and we check off our good deed and move on. Justice is dynamic. It's a powerful movement. Rightness or righteousness gives rise to justice. One seminary professor I had said that justice is simply love with legs. And it seems that worship without justice really isn't worship, according to what Amos is telling us as God's message. Justice is without worship wouldn't really be possible for who we are as God's people, it seems. The two seem to go together hand in hand. God was unwilling to accept the worship of those people in Bethel because the justice was absent from their lives the way they were living in their society. I like the words of one scholar who talks about the difference between church people and kingdom people. Listen to what he says. Church people often give church work the emphasis above concerns of justice, mercy, and truth. But kingdom people first seek the kingdom of God and its justice. Church people think about how to get people into the church. Kingdom people think about how to get the church into the world. Church people worry about what the world, you know, how the world might change the church. Kingdom people work to see the church change the world. And so through Amos, the Lord calls us to action so that the world might see the light of Christ in us, a light that redefines Christianity. Christ as living water calls us, I think, to be a kingdom church. And perhaps God wants our worship to spill out of the walls in the form of justice for all, overflowing into the streets of this New River Valley, the nation, and the world. And God wants the world to know that we're Christians, but not because we come here on Sundays, but because of our acts of love, mercy, and grace, ever flowing in the moment, every moment, beautiful and full of life. God wants overflowing worship. And so through Amos, God invites us to see and ponder and pray upon these new possibilities. God invites us to see the water, to touch it, and to live it, its life-giving power, its a beautiful movement, and its ability to change the course of the land. God calls us out of the routine of our worship and into the world. Where are we plugged in? How and where? When does our worship overflow? Are we in a rut? Has worship become routine? If Amos were to walk into our churches all over today, wonder what he would have to say to us.
Screen.
As we prepare for a time of prayer, I invite you now to share any joys or concerns for us to keep in mind as we go to the Lord in prayer. Anybody? Maybe we'll start on Zoom. Anyone on Zoom have any joys or concerns to share?
I do. I would like to pray for Allison Unroe and her husband, Drew Taylor, and his uncle, Jerry Robinson.
Thank you. The others.
I have one.
Yes.
Keep my dad, Roger Goad, in your prayers. He is starting to go downhill rather quickly with his dementia to the point that he is wandering outside at night some. So we're getting a little bit concerned about what to do for him and what steps we should be taking next.
Thank you. Any others?
Can you hear me?
Anyone else?
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
I would like to request prayers for my friend Cindy, whose granddaughter Megan was killed almost a year ago in a horrific car crash where they crossed the center line. There were four young people killed. Mm. And the mother's name is Cheryl. And pray for all of the Davis family. I would appreciate it.
Thank you. Anyone here in our midst or on the screen? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Holy and gracious God, what a blessing it is to worship you in word and song and action. May our worship overflow. Where there is hunger, may we offer food, for you are our bread of life. Where there is thirst, may we offer drink, for you are our living water. In the midst of divisiveness, grant us unity. And in the midst of disagreement, grant us calm, rational voice. In the midst of fear, fill our spirits with truth and courage. And where there is the darkness of hate, cover it with the light of your love. For those living with illness and pain, we ask for your peace. Equip caregivers and loved ones with hope and strength and perseverance. Comfort those who mourn as they struggle with loss, and protect those who defend freedom. Give us eyes to see, ears to hear, and hands and feet to serve those who suffer from the hands of injustice of all forms. And strengthen our voices to speak up, broaden our embrace, and soften our hearts to love as you love. May they know we are Christians, not by where we worship and how we worship, but by our love. And we ask these things in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Justice.
Somebody has on the Glade. I can remember. Come up just a little bit. And I got my glasses out. Will you turn around so I can see the back of the t-shirt? I was looking at this before worship started. This is your t-shirt. Be the church. Protect the environment. Care for the poor. Forgive often. Reject racism. Fight for the powerless. Share earthly and spiritual resources. Embrace diversity. Love God. Enjoy this life. I think that is exactly what God was telling us through Amos as God's people. So go into the world with hearts and voices filled with a spirit of justice, peace, and unity, knowing that you are held in the love of God who made every living soul, encouraged by Christ who reminds us to not lose heart, and empowered by the Holy Spirit who moves in and among us for the work of justice. Amen.